As you can see, the topic is about how to become a successful data scientist. And, you know, while on one hand, I am sure I would be the last person to tell you that there is just a simple single formula to be one, but at least you need to know a little bit about how to pave the path towards that particular goal, right? And this is what we are going to discuss today. So we will talk about what are the building blocks for a rewarding career in data science. And the reason why we are talking about it and why you have joined is there is a clear-cut requirement in the market out there with respect to jobs that you guys would like to attack, right? Otherwise, why? I mean, otherwise, without that kind of a traction in the market, nobody would be interested, correct? So it is the need which is driving us towards this particular field. So while we are saying that, we should, you know, go ahead and understand what it takes to be one, right? So a little about myself. I started my journey in this particular beautiful field, largely speaking, as a mainframe developer back in 2006, right? I worked on something known as SAS, SAS, right? Which is a very old language, very, very established language when it comes to data analytics and predictive modeling. And I used to work on SAS and SQL on mainframes, solving problems inside call pricing for telecom domain, right? Then I shifted to another company named Tesco. Tesco is a retailer, and it was there that I used similar skills to optimize their supply chain, right? And it was there that I was very, very clear in my head that I really, really do want to work closely in this area and, you know, basically how I want to create a particular roadmap for myself, correct? And it was there that I pursued a full-time degree program offered by Indian Institute of Science. And that's how I developed the skill set that was required in today's market to be a successful data scientist, correct? After that, this was in 2014, right? After that, I worked with a startup where I started their predictive analytics and distributed computing team. And for good 3 years, I was associated with that company named Data Semantics. You can find that in my LinkedIn profile as well. And it was almost 1.5 years back that I left that company, and now I am with Fidelity Investments, right? So it gives us it that sort of journey gives me a good understanding of the job environment of technologies being used in this particular field. And to one of the questions which is being asked is how much hype and how much is real truth about data science in today's scenario, right? If you look at the number of jobs which are out there are many. Would you argue against that? Can someone say that no, there are no jobs in this particular field in the market? Let me ask you that. And I will, you know, push for answers, because otherwise, you know, I will not understand whether you have my point has been received by you or not. So please participate via chatting, right? Please do that. So how many of you think that, you know, the jobs are not there, like it is just a hype? You don't see as many jobs in either LinkedIn or Naukri.com or whatever, right? How many of you think that way? How many of you feel that way, that there are not enough jobs in data science? Okay, so Vikas, it's good to have skeptics around us, right? It is always good to ask those difficult questions. You know, otherwise you will, you know, get swayed by the rhetoric. What everyone is saying will be your view, and that's not good. So we need to understand things as they stand, right? So therefore, this is a very important question and good question to start out with. So Salman brings out a very good point. So jobs are there, right? Nope. I don't think if you look at those particular job postings, you will find that jobs are definitely there. But On one side, so basically there is a disconnect, right? On one side, the disconnect is about, you know, how much quality those jobs are holding. That many times we are not able to figure out which is a good job, which is a sort of okay job, etc. Right? So that we need to figure out on our side. Secondly, sometimes on the employer side also, what they do is they have their own expectations, right? Weird expectations from a person who is across the table, right? So that sort of brings in, you know, two differing kind of issues when it comes to job search. And that is a real struggle. Most certainly there is a real struggle there, right? But so Vikash's view seems to be that, you know, data science is more about automation, right? But no, that's wrong. We will see exactly what it is about, and therefore, definitely we will address the idea of what data science, what kind of problems today, specifically data science solves, right? It is not about only, it is about automation up to a little extent, but it is more than that, right? Because when we say something about automation, it seems that the task that we are doing is lesser in value, correct? That's not the case. Task can be very, very, you know, valuable. And when automated, it can bring in like quadruple that particular value, correct? So therefore, don't imagine or restrict yourself to a small definition that machine learning or artificial intelligence is all about automating tasks. It is about that, definitely so. But the advantages to be gathered out of that particular automation are really, really high valued. And that is the reason why, you know, data science, good data scientists are in demand today. Again, I appreciate Vikash asking that question straight up, right? Whether data science is a hype or not. I would not say it is a hype simply because I know my stuff. That's how I would answer it, correct? If you are just sort of just another guy in the field out there, definitely it is a hype because you will not be able to ride that particular wave, right? But for the people who know their stuff well, right, who have solved multiple problems using those techniques and who have, you know, invested a lot of time and effort in developing those techniques for themselves, right? Definitely it is an opportunity. So always that is the difference between hype and non-hype, that people who are good at what they do can make use of so-called hype and, you know, get way ahead in their careers. And those who are on the sidelines, who don't know how to utilize that particular way, those are the ones that sort of call this particular thing as a hype. That's my very, very blunt view about it. Okay. And please don't mind my sort of, you know, way of putting things bluntly as my arrogance. It is just that I like to put things as I see them, right? And then I consider my audience's emotional responses. So please don't mind me sometimes making strong points. Okay, so yeah, this is all really good, and I hope I have addressed some good initial sort of problems about what we are going to discuss today. Okay, couple of questions were also there about data science related to Internet of Things, IoT, and the answer is that it does not matter whether it is related to IoT or not. See, IoT is nothing but, or Internet of Things is nothing but a way of getting things done automatically. That's all, right? So wherever you generate data, correct, you can use data science. As simple as that. So whether IoT is based on data science, that is wrong, because IoT solves certain tangible problems which are there in the field. But largely the scope of IoT is like, if this is data science, it is a component of Internet of Things, right? Because using data science along with Internet of Things solves the problem. So therefore, it's not that IoT is based on data science, but it is that IoT and data science are two independent things. And, you know, so unfortunately, in this format, I would not be able to open up the conversation for you guys as audience. I'm really sorry for that upfront, because we have a lot to cover as well, right? So please bear with me on that. Okay, I will not be able to unmute individuals at the back end. You can feel free to sound your opinions in the chat window, please. Okay. So, is data science incomplete with AI and machine learning? I do not understand that question, and we will get to the reasons as we go along, right? So, data science as a jargon. So all these are some jargons which I don't like, correct? Okay. Incomplete without AI and machine learning. Yes. So, think about, okay, how did it all start? Simple. Somewhere in 1920s, right? Somebody wrote a book in which they described certain machines which have human-like intelligence, right? And that's where artificial intelligence as a jargon came across, right? But even today, we are still struggling to create such machines, right? There is no hope that in next 20 years, we will be able to reach there. As simple as that, correct? So, starting from that large kind of a goal of creating machines which have human intelligence, we are somewhere started just now. We have somehow started walking our baby steps towards that larger goal. Let me put it that way. And whatever is known as artificial intelligence, data science, machine learning, statistics, blah, 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 right? All of this. All these are just some set of tools, I would put it, which are allowing us to reach to that stage. Okay. So is data science incomplete without AI and machine learning? Answer is yes. I mean, and the question, you have to understand that me as a person again, okay. Again, see statistics, right? It is again a tool, that nothing more than that, nothing less than that. Correct. So me as a person, I hate jargons. How I look at it is, see, statistics, why stop at statistics, right? Statistics is nothing but a, you know, child of mathematics for that matter. Mathematics as a, you know, concept is a child of philosophy for that matter, correct? So, yeah, all these are a part and parcel of the, you know, umbrella that is data science. We are here solving certain problems. That's what data scientists do, correct? Using different tools coming from statistical background, coming from machine learning background, coming from deep learning / artificial intelligence background, right? We use all these tools simultaneously to solve the problem that we are trying to solve. Does it actually answer the question? So basically, data science is nothing but an umbrella of techniques and tools which help solve certain problems which could not have been solved otherwise. Okay. What kind of problems are there? We will look at it. Okay. How those problems have evolved over a period of time, that also we will try to understand so that we can get a perspective of where things were and where we are today. Okay. We will cover all that. So don't worry. Okay. Allow me to highlight that first point again. What we are saying here is, boss, why is data science important? That's what we are trying to answer here. Correct? So, I'm sorry. Just a minute, guys. Sorry guys. So basically, why are we doing data science? That is an important question to ask, don't you think? And can you tell me why are companies investing in data science? Why? Like, is it just for the fun of it? Is there a tangible benefit there, or is it just to showcase that, yeah, we are a modern company and here, look, we are investing in data science teams? What do you feel? To make decisions that are close to the needs of the customers. Very good. So basically what we are saying is data science is used for two tasks. One, increase the top line. Top line meaning revenue, correct? So how can we create new business models using data that we are collecting from our end customers and generate new streams of, identify new streams of revenue? That is the first thing. Second, how can we bring optimization, or how can we improve the efficiency of existing processes which are, you know, driving our costs? So basically reducing the cost and improving the revenue, largely what it translates to increase in the profit. Unless whatever we are doing, whichever problem we are solving, is not directly associated or not directly attacking either reduction in the cost or improvement in the revenue, don't do it. Simple. I always say this particular one statement in everything that I speak when it comes to data science. Okay. If you think that the project that you are doing is not increasing the revenue, neither it is reducing the cost, it's not a project that you should be part of. Simple. Okay. So data science as a tool, as a set of tools, is responsible for enabling an improvement in revenue and reduction in cost by virtue of allowing us to, you know, improve our decision making process, making more data driven decisions rather than gut based decisions, right? And provide inputs to our strategies so that we can take decisions which we could not have taken so far, improve the relationships with the customer, improve the understanding of the risk elements within our environment that the firm operates in, and improve the financial performance, etc. Right? So these are the reasons why companies are trying to go in this particular field. That's what we are saying. Right? Now, what kind of skills that are required? Now, everybody that you speak to, right, would always tell you that there are two types of things that are required. One is, you know, your knowledge of mathematics and statistics and AI and ML and thousand different other jargons, correct? Supervised learning, unsupervised learning, optimization methods, and so on and so forth, right? Second is, you should know how to use SQL, how to use Python, how to use R. You may have questions about, such as, you know, whether supervised learning is better than unsupervised learning or not. There is some other animal named reinforcement learning, whether it is good, like whether that is the best thing to do or not, or whether Python is better than R, or whether SQL should be learned or not, whether it is useless, whether Spark should be learned or not. All these things are, well, I would not say that they are not of importance, but exactly. So as an example, role of Java in data science, right? So see, simple answer to all these kind of questions is, you want to develop skill set that suits your organization, right? That suits the demand of the market. And that is the first. And second is, which solves the problem at hand, correct? Now, what is the demand of the market today? Demand of the market is largely when it comes to, programming languages as used within analytics, right? Within data science, largely they use Python or they use R. There is relatively very lesser demand for Java in your data science related projects, very simply put. Okay. However, Scala has some demand. For those who know Java, it is easy to pick up on Scala, and therefore Spark related jobs are pretty much there out there for you to go for, right? So once you know a good bit of Scala and Spark, you can definitely call yourself a Spark developer. And if you understand all that there is to understand about supervised learning and supervised learning, you can ensure that you have that breadth of skill set which will make you employable. Okay. That's how it looks like. But and without Scala, can we learn Spark? Definitely yes. But the only other useful language that Spark works with is Python, right? So either it is Scala or Python. Java is also there. I am not saying that you can't run Spark with Java. Okay. For others who don't know what Spark is, do not worry. It is just another data processing framework for that matter, right? So it supports you coding in Java. It supports you coding in Scala. It supports you coding in Python as well as up to certain extent R. Okay. It does support all four languages. However, from a performance perspective, from a practical hands-on perspective, yes, either it is Scala or it is Python. Okay. And again, from where we can start, obviously I would suggest Python because that's what I use, right? It does not mean that you can't use Java, you can't use Scala. I repeat that the skill set on the programming side is largely a function of your own environment, where you are going to be employed, correct? If the team that you are working with on data science problem, if they already use Java to solve that particular problem, well, there is no way. Even I will code in Java, correct? However, for most of the team, for most of the parts, you will see that they will work with either Python, PySpark, or R. That's all. That's what I have seen in my experience. Okay. But still, there are companies, there might be some teams which might be working with some different languages, like Julia for that matter, right? But there are very rare such scenarios, largely. Okay. Does it answer your question? So basically, what I'm saying is this is not all, right? Programming and mathematics behind the algorithms are just two elements that makes a good data scientist. What are the others, right? That is more important question for me. The others, to understand the others, what we need to understand is what is the way in which data science problems are constructed. Let us keep a close eye on the watch. It is 7:26 right now. So we will have to go a little bit faster. So basically what we are saying here is there are these six steps in which we go about. First is to frame the problem, correct? Do you think your knowledge of programming languages and your knowledge of what else did we talk about? Algorithms, right? Your knowledge of programming languages and algorithms allow you to frame the problem better? Do you think knowledge of mathematics and knowledge of programming help you frame the problem better? Step one is framing the problem, right? Does it help you to frame the problem better? Does it help you to define your problem in a nice way? Exactly. So Imran very clearly says NO, no, and that is correct. The only thing that allows you to frame the problem better is your business understanding. Okay. So remember that. That part will never be able to, like beyond a point, no one will be able to teach you, right? It has to be you who generate that kind of a skill set. That is the first point that you should remember. And we will talk about this in detail in just next slide. Okay. Second part is collecting the raw data. Here, maybe if you know SQL, if you know Python, R, or whatever, right? So here maybe that knowledge will come handy for you to sort of, collect the data from various, using various technologies and process it, right? So collection of raw data, processing of the data, this is where a large part of your, programming understanding will help, right? Exploring the data. Now, those who are from visualization field who are keeping an eye on the visualization field, there are many tools like Tableau and Big Sense and what else, Power BI, right? Which allow you to explore the data in a very fast manner. Okay. So again, there your programming skills can definitely come into picture, but without that also today, it is possible to explore the data. Okay. And then finally performing in-depth analysis is where all the algorithms will come in, will allow you to, explore like, create models which can be used to solve the aforementioned framed problem, right? And then final part is the communication of results. Again, first part and last part. Do you think anything on the how much ever expert you are in mathematics, how much ever expert you are in programming, is part 1 and 6 anywhere related to that? The answer is no. Okay. So let's understand over and above those two main components, what else is there for us to sort of keep an eye on? So some critical and yet underrated traits of a great data scientist is commitment to the solution of the problem. You will find a lot many people involved in the process, right? There will be IT department, there will be business, there will be project management folks, and there are just so many people involved in this particular, these kind of projects, that it can be very irritating to deal with people, right? But if you are, unless you are committed for the success of the project, unless you are a proactive go-getter, these kind of projects will not go well. Okay, so commitment is very, very important. And so are creativity and intuition. So I'm taking fourth and the last point together. Creativity and intuition, I will give an example. So right now I'm solving a particular problem for which the data is, you know, out there in, you know, various websites, correct? So then like when it came to asking the question, where is the data? I was told that, you know what, as a person, I go to these 10, 15 websites and I keep going there and I try to find the relevant articles and then I solve the problem. Now, if an algorithm has to do that, how difficult it can be, can you imagine? Right? So I have to be creative. I have to be a person who can look beyond those obvious obstacles. And I need to have an intuition as to how, even when I have never solved that particular problem before, can I solve it? Right? So creativity and intuition are the things that I must have. And it is not that overnight it is, you know, generated. It is by your reading. So every day I spend at least 1 hour talking about, or not talking about, but understanding, reading and you know, talking to experts. And that way, at least one and a half hours each day on an average, I spend reading about how others solve their various problems, right? That helps me think, right? The more I think, the more creativity flows out of me. And therefore, given any new problem, I am able to sort of recollect how others have solved those problems. And, you know, given the constraints that this new problem has, how I can be creative and solve this particular problem using my, you know, knowledge that I have gained just from talking to others, right? So therefore, creativity and intuition play a very vital role in getting quick successes, right? And they cannot be generated. They need to. The more you speak to others, the more you listen from others, the more you read, that is one way to sort of, you know, quote unquote, hire the creativity from experts, hire the intuition from the experts, and, you know, build it, embed it in your own brain, right? Next is business savviness and presentation skills. These are the things which no one can teach you. Largely, no one will teach you. Okay. Even if so, I have done masters in management, right? Even there, whatever we were taught from a theoretical standpoint about business functions like finance, HR, and, you know, operations research and supply chain and whatnot, right? Nowhere it works the way in which the books say it works. And I'm sure that you guys are aware of it, right? So the more closely you align with the business, the guy who is sitting on the desk where the decisions are being made, the more time you spend with him, the more you listen about his own problems in his own language, the better you are. Okay. And this no one can teach you. This, for this, you need to be open in your mind, be respectful for others' times, and so on and so forth. Okay. Only and only then can you, So only and only then can you sort of be able to have empathy with the business person, right? Or if you are the business person, then great. All you need to do is be able to understand the other part of it. What is the other part? The programming part, the various algorithm part. And because what will happen is eventually it is your duty to ensure that if a data scientist is thinking in wrong way, you should be able to bring the context of business in his thinking and align his aims and objectives in the best possible manner. Understood? So those who are from the business side of it, so I will flip the side now. Now, for those of you who are on the business side of it, they should think like this. I know the business. I can understand and identify the problem in a better way. All I need to ensure is whoever is solving, like if I am to the one who is solving this problem, then I need to sort of keep the business context at the topmost level, right? So that's that. These are the very many hats that you should wear, and you know, the experience that you have had in the past helps you in this business savviness and so on and so forth. Okay. Imran, okay, let's really park it, because a simple answer is, like everyone else would say, I don't think there is an edge, but I understand your question and I will try to cover it. If not, just remind me, Imran, please be kind enough. Okay. If by end of it, if I'm not addressing this question, I will address it in the usual blunt way possible. Okay. But later. All right. Now, last part is presentation. So Imran's question was, what is the maximum age? Can one switch and start working as a data scientist? Right? It's a very interesting question. I would not say that there is no age. Okay. I will address it the way I think it should be addressed, but at a later point. Okay. So last point here, the last skill that is important in my opinion is presentation skill. Point number 6, if you remember, was about presenting the results to the business. Unless you are able to weave a story out of it, it will just be simple numbers, dry numbers, which will not be interesting to a layperson sitting at the other end of the presentation. How much ever great work you had done, unless it is presented in a way that it is very easy for us to understand and more importantly relate with the result, you are not a successful data scientist. Okay. So over and above those obvious facts of programming and algorithms, all these are really, really important attributes that I respect if someone has, and therefore you should keep the eyes for it, keep the mind for it, open for it, so that you can learn all these non-tangible aspects as you go along your respective career paths. Okay. So I really request you to sort of focus on these intangible kind of skills as well in your journey of becoming a data scientist, because many times it is not algorithms, it is not programming, it is the presentation that matters. I would say most of the times it is the presentation and packaging of the solution that you, the way you convince the customer that this is what you need to use to excel, this is what will solve your problems, right? Unless you are good at that, it's very difficult, right? It's not useful that you know all the algorithms in the world, that you are a mathematical expert or whatever, right? It's all useless. So understand that these intangible skills are really, really important for success compared, and they're as important, at least if not more, as your, knowing mathematics, knowing algorithms and knowing tools like programming language, etc. Okay. Any questions so far? Do you think whatever we discussed was useful for you so far? Do you think this relates with you in some level, at some level? Thank you. Thanks for the feedback. Okay. It is very important that you stop me if it does not work. Okay. So are we still using fancy PPTs for the presentation, or something new has come up? Well, there are new things. Okay. By the way, there are new things. If you check, I have used something known as Presto, Presto DB. No. Sorry. There is some fancy thing that I had used. So it uses JavaScript and it's like zoom in, zoom out, then rotate and all that fancy stuff. Okay. So there are certain such kind of things, but again, fanciness should not be the motivation. Motivation should always be simplicity, right? The simpler you make, the easier it is for me to understand. I may not appreciate it the way if you make it complex and fancy and jazzy, but at the end of the day, I might be remembering, one thing I would like to remember is what I have taken away from it, what I have understood, not the jazziness of it, right? So remember that particular, at least I believe in that part very much. You will see how sad my, overall presentation is. Just to prove a point, I make it very jazzy. You only will remember jazziness. Okay. You will not remember my message. Not jazziness. I am for message. And that's what I'm giving you. Okay. So yes, fancy PPTs do help. It helps you initially just to wow the audience. And there are ways in which people do follow those kind of ways, but not me, at least not me here. Okay. And let me see. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Super. So thanks for your compliments and feedback, guys. Let's move on to the next level, right? So as we saw, these are the skills required, and I would not go ahead and talk about each detail. Rather than that, I'll give you, say, 10 seconds. Read through this. Specific questions we will answer. Otherwise, we will move on to the next part, which is more important. Okay, which is about businesses, how businesses are using this particular skill set, and how things have evolved from where they started and where they are today when it comes to use cases and businesses. So I will shut myself up for 10 seconds and you guys go through all these details and ask questions if there are. I will not answer very in-depth questions. I will say that I will maybe guide you towards some resources or whatever, because that's these in-depth question is not this topic is about, right? Today's topic is very generic in nature. So I will take a pause for 10 seconds, ask your questions, and I will answer them on their merit. All right. So there are a couple of questions. I think 10 seconds is over. So I will now address those questions. Okay. That is also important. So mathematical skills are required. Well, if you go to the depth of it, right, depth of the data science algorithms and deep learning algorithms, the mathematical, there is a considerably deep level of mathematics that is required. However, how you can look at it is, you can be the person who understands the implementation rather than the algorithm itself. Right? So there are many folks who know how to code an algorithm out. And therefore you can fill that gap even when you don't understand the math behind the algorithm. You have some idea about it, right? But you don't know entirety of it. That's the difference. Is that okay? From an algorithmic side, definitely a significant depth of mathematics is required, but it is not compulsory, is how I would put it. Okay. So A-B testing and control. Next question is about A-B testing and control time. Again, this is a technical question. I would say that if you just Google it at a later point, you will understand it. Largely, it is about, say, when you have, say, you are creating a new product, right? Say, this is the deck that I want to present to my customers. I present with white background as it is right now, and then I present it with black background, right? So I am testing which background is better for the end user to relate to with, right? Or understand, the end user is able to understand the background, the effect of background easily, right? So that is A-B testing kind of a thing. And control trials is where, say, you are offering a particular product, right? So you offer that product to general population and offer that product to a special niche set of population. So that kind of a thing is called control trials. So all these are part and parcel of statistical way of hypothesis testing, if you have heard about it. But again, it is a technical part of it. So I don't want to put it in that manner. Okay, right now. Couple of other questions are, these are the skill set that we would learn as part of program or, you know, syllabus. So basically, no, see, I understand the syllabus is largely about the mathematics of it, about the programming part of it, right? I told you that, you know, I have told you that not all the things will ever be covered, not especially the angles. These are all jargons that you are seeing here, right? Nobody will be able to cover all of it in one single program, full stop, right? So it is more the any program, any particular sort of syllabus, right, will cover the necessary and important elements based on which you can learn all of this by yourself, correct? So as an example, algebra, linear algebra and multivariate calculus. Will someone teach you in any particular course? The answer is no, right? Even in IISc, nobody taught us these things. What they did teach was, where is it applicable and how to understand it intuitively? Don't worry much about the proofs. Don't worry much about the, implication. Don't worry too much about the mathematics involved, but at least worry about how to understand it. Why is it being used, right? How to read the results. Many times the results will be some number. Now, whether that number is good, bad, whatever, right? You have to have some background over here, just limited amount of background to be able to appreciate you of that. Okay. So therefore, even when none of these topics might be as is in your training programs, it is perfectly fine. Why? Because whatever topics are being covered are covered in a way that you are sort of, you know, covering the base, creating a base for it. And then standing on that base, you can sort of build on top of it and reach to a particular height where you are set for your life, right? So, and in any case, the intangibles, like, you know, communication of the results or framing the problem, that no one can teach. That you have to, you know, do a lot on the ground to be able to appreciate, be able to do it, right? So that's how you have to understand every course. And in that sense, from a developing the various broad skill set perspective, I think, Manipal has decent programs to work with, basically, right? So that's the way to look at it, okay? From a open source project perspective, well, Vikas, so what Vikas is asking is, is there any open source project that they can work on and try to, you know, add in their resume? Simple. All of you should know about Kaggle, kaggle.com. I will just type it out so that you can check it by yourself. Okay. So Kaggle is one of the many options that are available for you to learn from. Is that okay? So there are multiple, competitions that happen, and you can learn from others there. So others who are experts would post their analysis initially, okay? And you can try and learn from there. So other similar platforms are there, like, let me remember, there was this Crowd Analytics, I think, crowdanalytics.com, right? And what else? I don't remember much about them, but yeah, there are 4 to 5 respectable such options available on the open internet. Okay. So that will give you enough data, enough number of problems to sort of try out whatever you have learned in this particular area. Okay. And in fact, as I said, you can always learn from others. That's for a daily basis, right? So there is enough and more material that others have put there so that you can learn from that. Okay. What else? So from a entry level barrier, anybody can get into data science. See, theoretically speaking, you don't need Manipal Pro Learn, theoretically speaking. Why? Because there are, videos by IIT professors, by MIT professors for free on YouTube. But the problem is that you need to have that personal touch, right? That you need to have someone to guide you, someone to help you when you are stuck. And that is the only reason why a rich ecosystem like Manipal ProLearn and other courses come into picture. They help you in moments where you are stuck. If you follow only the videos, well, you may end up, getting stuck, and without any help, you will struggle, right? So that is the way to look at it. So anyone can get into data science. There are many ways in which you can learn about all these techniques. You can read books if the need be. You can watch all those videos on YouTube. Hopefully you will find the quality ones over there. And you can learn from likes of Manipal ProLearn courses, right? All these options are there. The only reason why you would want Manipal ProLearn type of environment is there they support the students to the hilt. They provide you consultation when you are stuck. They provide you resources so that you can learn in the best possible way and utilize your time in best possible way, right? So that's why anyone can get into data science, and a constructive way can be of utilizing your time can be such kind of nice, collected courses, basically properly structured courses, right? So that's that. So are you all with me so far? I think 10 minutes will not do much justice with the later part, but this was the important part. So, I wanted you all to be sort of, clean in your head about these parts. Any further questions, or do you think there are any questions that I have skipped so far? All right. So now I think it's best if I go for ahead. Okay. So let me. So question, like I always ask this question to myself when I was learning so-called data science, right? I was asking boss, who will pose those problems for me? Any business is created from one or more of these pillars, right? These are all five pillars of any business, right? So strategy, this includes risk management, right? Forecasting, looking at the future, correct? Marketing, this includes, spending money on getting the clients basically to your firm to buy whatever a firm generates. These are the people who ensure that whatever is generated is sold as well, right? Operations, so how the generation will happen, that's operation. Who will generate? People, right? Where will money come from? How will that be managed? It's finance. So each and every company will have, will have all these five pillars, and for them, sometimes one pillar will be more important than others, right? So for Google, right? So marketing is the main pillar. Why? Because they earn their money from that, right? Facebook, same. Marketing is the way in which they can earn their money, right? They provide a platform to market, and it is using that platform that people or Facebook makes money, correct? So basically these are the five places from where the data is coming from where the problem statements are coming from. And I again repeat that whatever problem statement you are trying to solve should always cater to improving the revenue or reducing the costs. Okay. So that's something which we must be mindful about. Okay. Now, so basically this is where the entire problem statements will come from, and this is how things have changed. Right. So if we talk about the latest fad or latest, not, I will not talk about it as a fad, because it has some very, very, important utility in today's world that we live in. Right. The jargon that is most famous today is not ML, is no longer even AI. It is deep learning. Correct. So the kind of things that deep learning allows us to do is solve some problems related to natural language processing. Now, what does natural language processing stand for? It stands for understanding the natural language, generating the natural language, and yes, so NLU, natural language understanding, NLG, natural language generation, right? And NLI for that matter, natural language inference. So reading comprehension kind of capabilities, right? All these capabilities were not, they were, you look at 5 years back, right? NLP was limited to spell check and grammar check. That's it. Right. But within last 5 years, we have Alexa in our home. They it understands not only the text, but also the voice, right? So that kind of innovation has happened in just last 5 years. No, not more, right? And basically, you know, we have Siri, we have Google Home, we have Alexa, and so on and so forth, right? So that is the kind of difference that you are seeing thanks to deep learning, right? When it comes to natural language processing, computer vision, right? 5 years back, it was limited to, okay, red eye reduction in the photos, right? There used to be this red eye and all that. So it was about red eye reduction. Now today it is about facial recognition, or in last 5 years, it was about facial recognition, fingerprint recognition, and so on and so forth. But here onwards, it is going to be about video segmentation, video analytics, real-time video analytics, and stuff like that, right? So, and autonomous driving and stuff like that. So basically, computer vision in just last 5 years and onwards has come a very long way thanks to, again, deep learning, right? So basically, what we are saying here in this particular slide is gone, like, we are not saying that the older problem about, say, risk management or marketing, you know, management, or when I say marketing management, what I mean is machine learning and AI was used for years together to sell you more, right? It was used to cross-sell products, to upsell products. It was used to improve what is known as lifetime value of the customers, right? LTV, lifetime value, right? So marketing wise, those were the problems that used to be solved using AI and ML, right? Till now. But today it has changed, and that change is reflected in this particular slide, right? Similarly, risk assessment. So when it comes to finance, right? What is the risk of the portfolio? How much money am I going to lose if things go bad? Right? So that was a very standard and established problem that people used to try and solve using statistics and later using AI, ML, etc. Right? But today, even that has changed to things like diagnostic maintenance or predictive maintenance, right? So rather than risking a failure of a machine, can we predict the failure and therefore take corrective steps, right? That's where, and one of the, you had asked the question about, IoT, right? So IoT is one of the use cases in Internet of Things is predictive maintenance. How can we predict the health score of a particular running machine so that if at all it is going to go down, we should know, right? So those kind of use cases are today's use cases, right? That is the gradual shifting as it comes to, machine learning and AI use cases. Then what else? Let us go and check operations, right? And people. HR analytics has come a long way today, right? Many times you will see now on that even your resumes will be shortlisted by algorithms, not people, right? So basically that's where AI ML solutions are going to be used, right? Operations, how can we optimize the way in which things are being done? How the route is optimized for Swiggy delivery? How the route is optimized for Big Basket and Grofers delivery? Using AI ML and largely optimization techniques, correct? So, these are the today's use cases rather than yesterday where you just using certain just heuristics, you define all those things and finish it off, right? Today, there is data, there are advanced mathematical techniques to use that data and solve the problem. So we use all of it together. And third is technology. There is technology which will solve this particular problem sensible amount of time so that we can use that result in real time, correct? So all these three together have evolved in a way so as to sort of support your decision, okay? And that's where I will sort of ask for a stop, in the sense that starting from what is, let's recapitulate where we were, right? So starting from the place about understanding the skills required as a data for becoming a good data scientist, not only the hard skills that are related to programming and algorithms which are covered properly in Manipal's various courses, right, are required. But also there are soft skills which nobody can teach you. That are all, those are also required. And this, in this session, if there is one thing that you need to remember, is this very statement, right? That you need to be aware of the storytelling capabilities, the framing the business problem capabilities and stuff like that, to be able to sort of be an effective data scientist.
Hey, thanks for watching. Do like the video and share it, and also don't forget to subscribe to our channel for more such videos. And check out the exclusive coupon codes for our YouTube learners in the description below. And visit moneypalprolearn.com to redeem them.